with one variable systems, linear flows, then understanding fixed points that grew in terms of bifurcations and other nonlinear phenomena. And then from there, we entered linear systems, coupled systems. We complicated our systems equations a bit more to get this nonlinear coupled differential equations. And now we are quite equipped to solve problems as complicated as a nonlinear term like sine theta sitting in our equation, as established in our last class. So in our last class, we were talking about this not so linear oscillator, right? So let me just switch on my camera. I guess you can see my notebook now. So we were discussing about this not so linear oscillator, right? We solved this problem, wrote down the equations, splitted the two variable, the second order equation into two first order equations to begin with. Then we wrote down the solutions, we figured out the Jacobians, and then we worked out that how we had this consecutive series of centers and followed by saddles, and we drew this entire phase space. We also mapped it onto a cylindrical shaped coordinate system, and we saw that this could be beautifully repeated if I consider that plotted on top of a cylinder, where consecutively the saddle and the saddle and the center comes into the picture. This gets repeated again and again. So it is very well mapped on a cylindrical coordinate system. So as understood from our discussion in the last class, I just want to just tell a few things just to remember those stuff so that we can begin our discussion today. That it basically tells you that if a pendulum it is at rest, then it can stay there because it's a neutrally stable point, right? So it can stay there. If you put a little bit of energy to that particular pendulum, then small oscillations begin. And these circles were basically in the velocity versus theta space, if you remember. So this was velocity versus theta space, right? And we saw that this small oscillations were came out as it was a center, right? Then if the energy is a little bit more, then we resulted into this saddle fixed point. And saddle was nothing but the inverted pendulum. So we talked about this. So this is the inverted pendulum that is basically a very, very unstable fixed point saddle, because it is stable from one direction, unstable from the other. And we drew the flow lines to establish that. So if the energy is more than even reaching the saddle, so that means oscillations where it goes up and then comes back and goes like this and comes back and so on, this kind of oscillations are meant by these lines that pass through the saddle. So these big ellipses that pass through the saddle basically means this inverted oscillations. Just beyond that, there is no coming back. It is beyond the fixed point. So it goes away like this and it comes back and it rotates. It does not have the oscillatory motion anymore, which are signified by these wavy lines on the top. So in the wavy lines on the top, you can see that there is no position where the velocity becomes zero. So if you are in an ellipse position, ellipse like a phase space, then the velocity is somewhere or other zero. That means the oscillator stops at a certain point. If you cross this inverted position, then there is no coming back. It goes on round and round and the velocity is never zero. That is why you see this kind of wavy lines. Okay. So this much we understood in our last class. Today we want to just expand our idea about whatever we have learned in terms of energy. And by energy, I mean the good old energy that we already know, like potential energy, our equation, Newton's law, P is equal to mf, and something like that. So if I ask you that associated our oscillator, then the equation of motion of any particle with a mass m, and not only an oscillator, any particle with a mass m, we know that this is given by mx double dot is equal to fx. So that is our my Newton's law, right? Mx double dot is equal to fx. And then we replace this fx in terms of the potential energy. And we write that mx double dot is equal to minus dv dx, or if I take it on this side, then I have plus dv dx, okay? So this is the equation of motion, okay? So as from the definition of conservative systems, if you remember, conservative systems, we used to write this entire thing in terms of the energy and making it as an exact time derivative. And from there, we called those systems conservative because their energy was conserved, right? So how to make this into a equation where this is like just simple basic mechanics that we have learned. So just let us, you will quickly understand that why I'm doing this exercise all over again. So if I want to turn this into a exact time derivative, then what do? I multiply this equation on both sides by x dot. So I multiply each and every term by x dot, okay? And I equate that to zero. And if I do that, then basically by using this simple thing that if I have ddt of v of xt, okay, then I can break it up as dv dx times dx dt, right? I can break it up like this as dv dx times dx dt. And just using the other way of this, the same equation, giving the using this particular chain rule, we can write this equation as ddt of half m x dot square plus vx, right? So whatever sits inside this bracket is my energy that I know, that is the total energy, right? That is the total energy of the system, whatever is sitting inside the bracket. And the equation is telling me that the time derivative of this particular quantity, energy, is zero. By signifying that it's a constant function, constant as a function of time, it's constant. So the energy is often called a conserved quantity, a constant of motion or something like that, right? So these systems where we have this quality, we call that those systems as conservative systems. So this is something that we know from our study of basic mechanics that we already have studied so many times. So today, what I want to do is to relate the idea of energy and conservative systems with the nonlinear oscillator, not so linear oscillator that we have derived and figured out the phase space of. So what we will try to do today is from the phase diagram that we already have figured out, we will try to map or draw an energy diagram. Okay. So by energy diagram, what I mean is this. Just consider in the same way as I did here, consider the equation that I had for the simple pendulum, okay? And let us try to write down or figure out what the energy will be in that particular case, okay? So that is the first step that I need you to do, is to try and write down the equation of motion that was theta double dot plus sine theta is equal to zero. That was the equation. We just changed the variables so that we can get rid of omega, if you remember. Okay, so I am taking that equation and I am trying to see that is it a conservative system or not, or if it is a conservative system, then what is basically given by the energy expression. Okay, so to see that, I do the same trick that I have done here. I multiply both sides by theta dot. Okay, so theta double dot sine theta is equal to zero, and do the same thing to see that what is the energy quantity. So that tells me that ddt of half theta dot square minus cos theta is equal to zero. That means this is the energy and this is constant. Okay, so up to this point, is it fine that I can see that this is the energy associated with the system? Just we got rid of all the excess things. That is why it is looking a little bit wild, but this is the energy, and you can simply relate it with your basic fundamentals about simple harmonic oscillator. Just ignore the omega term sitting there and you will get the same notions, a similar notion, similar kind of an idea about what should be the total energy. So in this particular system, that is the sine theta, the nonlinear oscillator with the sine theta term, this quantity half theta dot square minus cos theta is basically representing the energy of the system. Okay, and this is conservative because I am seeing the total energy is remaining constant. Okay, so with this notion about the energy, now I am going to ask you that can I relate the trajectories that we drew in the last class? Okay, the trajectories that we drew in the last class, the circles, the ellipses, the big ellipses passing through the saddle point, and these wavy lines with the energy value. Okay, so if I want to relate that, just think about the simple harmonic oscillator and think that it is becoming more and more energetic and it is oscillating. So you can just simply imagine that scenario and try to relate each and every special position on this phase space with a certain energy value. Okay, so the first thing that I'm going to ask, that what is the minimal value of this quantity? If I ask you that, what will be the minimum value of this quantity?
Zero.
Can it be less than that? So just see the equations that we have made using the two first order equations. Let me just see what were the two variables. If I want to split that second order differential equation in terms of two first order equations, we had two variables, right? One was theta, another one was v, and v was theta dot, if you remember, right? So that is how we solved the entire problem in the last class, considering one of the variable as theta and the other variable as v, where v was equal to theta dot. Now in this particular expression that we have here, okay, we have half theta dot square minus cos theta. That means in our term of parameter, it is half v square minus cos theta. Okay, so let me write that down, half v square minus cos theta. That is how we splitted the second order differential equation into two first order coupled equations, and we solved the problem in the last class. Okay, so if I have an equation like this and you have a phase space diagram like that, okay, so can you tell me now that what would be the minimum value of this quantity E? What is the value if V is equal to zero? And we have V is equal to zero at some extreme positions like this, right? Where V becomes zero. Now remember that if I am talking about a conservative system, that means whatever the energy is at this point remains static for this entire contour, right? Because it's a conservative system, the energy does not go anywhere. So if I have a point where V is equal to zero on a particular trajectory, then I can put V equal to zero and say that that is the energy of the system for this entire trajectory. So just tell me if we are with me at this point. So are you understanding this, what I am saying?
Yes.
Okay, so what is the lowest possible energy state? The lowest possible energy state is when V is equal to zero. Okay, V is equal to zero means the energy at that point would be minus one. That is the lowest value that you can get. So V is zero and cos theta is at its minimum contribution. Okay, so then you have the minimum amount of energy. So energy close to this value or values, so the energy cannot go any further down. Can it go any further down? No, right? Because I have V square here. Even for negative values of V, that contributes as a positive number, and cos theta as a negative term can maximally contribute one. Okay, so the lowest I can make this function is minus one. Are you with me? Right? The lowest value of E could be minus one. So that is the lowest possible energy state where there is no oscillation. The thing is just neutrally sitting on this particular point. Now, small orbits surrounding this center are for small energies, which are a little bit close to minus one, but a little bit higher than minus one. Okay. So as you go on increasing the energy of the system, you get this small and then a little bit bigger, then a little bit more big trajectories on your V theta space. And for the simple pendulum, it means that you are oscillating slowly, and then you are oscillating a bit fast in a much more larger amplitude, or you are oscillating vigorously. Okay, so these are all these different trajectories that we can see in our phase space. Okay, so at a critical case, I get these trajectories that pass through the saddle. That is a critical state where I get these trajectories that pass through the saddle. What would be the energy for that particular value? What do you think? What should be the energy of the system for that particular value? This particular trajectory, what is the threshold energy for that? Consider that this is the case of the inverted pendulum, right? So this is the case where the pendulum is just inverted. Now, can you tell me? When the pendulum is inverted? Yes?
Very little amount.
The energy?
Yeah.
So energy was minus one here. In our scale, the energy was minus one here. Then you increase the energy little bit, and you got this bigger and bigger trajectory. Just imagine that you have this simple pendulum, and you are forcing it with more and more energy. You are supplying more and more energy. That means it's oscillating more and more vigorously, right? And you are getting curves like this, bigger and bigger curves. Now, if your pendulum has reached the inverted state and then come back and reach the other inverted state on the other side and then come back, that means you are having the biggest possible amplitude. Okay. If you cross this point, instead of getting these oscillations, you will start getting this clockwise or anti-clockwise rotations. Okay. So what is the value of theta that we expect here at this point in time? From there, can you see that what would be the critical case?
It's 2 pi, 4 pi.
It is just inverted, right? The pendulum is just inverted. If the pendulum hanging straight is zero, then what would be the pendulum, just inverted pendulum? What would be theta for that?
2 pi.
Pi, right? Pi. So you have a pendulum like this, it is zero. If the pendulum is like that, then how much angle have you traveled?
Pi.
Is it confusing to some in any extent? You can tell me. So pendulum, that is this energy, right? Going straight, no angle, you had this energy, theta value was zero. Now your pendulum is going up to this point. That is your theta. Okay. If that is your theta, then what is the value of the energy that you have? Just remember minus that one. Plus one. You had a minus sign already there.
Plus.
Here you already have a minus sign. So it is plus one because this entire trajectories are of same energy. Okay. So if you can think of this extreme point and figure out what is the energy at this extreme point, that energy will remain fixed for the entire trajectory. So at this extreme point, the pendulum is inverted and its velocity is zero. Right, it will stop at that point. That is the extreme point of your oscillation. So it will stop at that point. You put velocity equal to zero. You put cos theta, theta is equal to pi, and you get energy is equal to plus one. Okay, energy is equal to plus one.
Hello,
corresponds
ma'am.
To the critical. Yes.
Ma'am, how can be the energy of the oscillator is negative? Shouldn't it be positive all the time?
No, yes, from one perspective you are right, but this is the energy function that we got from our expression, the conservative energy. Okay, so here just don't consider this term that there is no omega here and all these things we have thrown away. Okay, so energy for the static pendulum here in some scale is minus one. Don't consider it to be the absolute value of minus one. Okay, so it is the lowest possible state of energy, and for our scale it is minus one, and then it is growing to plus one, and at plus one you get these trajectories. So all these values are not absolute values, these are in our own scale in which we are considering all the physical quantities gone and we are dealing with just a simple equation like this. Okay, so if you have a scenario of this inverted pendulum, you are getting an energy is equal to one. Then that means that if in our this particular problem in our scale, if my energy goes beyond one, so if I have energy value beyond one, okay, energy value greater than one, then what happens? From this inverted position, the pendulum does not come back to oscillate, but it goes on forward to travel in a circular path. So it goes on like this. It rotates like this. Okay, its velocity never becomes zero, and that corresponds to these blue lines in my phase diagram. Okay, so these are all not oscillations, these are just rotations. Okay, so the first thing is the static pendulum, the next things are the small oscillations, or they were sometimes called librations, and this is these are the rotations. Okay, these are the rotations. The energy greater than one is pendulum whirling repeatedly over the top. Okay, and this is how the system, the energy of the system goes on. So if I now ask you that this cylindrical the phase space, you understood quite well, right, that how this phase space can fold and it can result into a cylinder, and this becomes a perfect match and it goes on forever and ever. Now if I ask you to draw a very interesting diagram in which I'll plot the energy in one axis, I'll plot the energy in one axis, okay, and on the other side I will see that how the dynamics is going on. So I need you to interrupt me at any point if you don't understand what I am discussing here. So we will take these references with us, that for e is equal to minus one it was just hanging like that, for greater values from e up to one it was continuously oscillating with greater and greater amplitude, and if the energy becomes more than one, then it is whirling round and round from the top. Okay, do you agree that as the energy will increase, the oscillation amplitude will increase, and we will see this kind of behavior? That much I guess you understand clearly, right, that if the energy of the oscillator increases, then the amplitude increases, and then the angle also changes up to which the oscillator can reach, and you get this different kind of oscillations, first small oscillations, then big oscillations, and then finally whirling around the top, over the top like this, which was not allowed in our simple harmonic oscillator because we turned our sine theta to be theta, so our angle was small, only small oscillations were allowed. Now we are allowing these big oscillations and over the top rotations as well. Okay, so with this information that this is how the energy changes and this is how the dynamics changes, I want to plot a diagram which is very important for understanding of these pendulums, and I hope that you will appreciate the beauty of it. So what I want to draw is a cylinder, okay, as the phase space, as we have discussed in the last class, I want to draw a cylinder as the phase space, okay, where somewhere here in the middle v is equal to zero. Okay, v increases on this side, v becomes negative, or negative values, higher values on this side, so velocity becomes plus or minus depending on what the values are. Okay, and the motion, the angular motion is considered like this, where this side is theta equal to 0, say, and this side is theta is equal to pi. Okay. So I am trying to understand that how the, if I consider energy instead of velocity along this axis, how this particular cylindrical landscape would change. Okay. If I am considering energy instead of velocity. So you can see that in terms of velocity, if I consider, then the velocity is increasing in the positive direction in one side and decreasing on the positive direction in the other side, as you have seen in this phase space diagram. Okay, this cylinder. This is the cylinder that I have drawn here. But if you consider in terms of energy, then instead of V, I have a V square sitting there. Instead of V, I have V square sitting here. That means this quantity will increase either way. Either if V increases in the positive side, then also V square increases. If V increases on the negative side, then also V square increases, right? So if I want to draw a diagram where I want to see that how the energy gets affected, if I want to draw a phase space in terms of the energy using the obvious symmetry, the cylindrical symmetry that I have, so plotting energy vertically instead of velocity, that is what I want to do. I want to plot in the vertical axis instead of velocity. I want to plot the energy, okay? Then how should the diagram look like? Okay, so let us see. I have a minimal value of the energy which I did not had for velocity. That is the first thing, okay? I want to draw a similar looking phase space. I don't know what kind of a shape will that be, but I have some information. The first information I have is that energy has a minimal value below which it will not go. Okay, when the pendulum is static, when the pendulum is just hanging there, the energy is -1 and it cannot go beyond that. Okay, so negative side, it is protected at -1, it is closed at -1. On the higher side, it can go, and for very high energies, it will well on the top, from the top, it will rotate like this. So if I want to draw this diagram, what kind of a diagram will I expect? As I already told you that this is a V square term sitting here. So if V was a linear kind of a setup, you had a cylinder where V was going on both sides. If I want to plot something like V square, then what kind of a diagram do you expect?
Parabola.
Parabola, very good, very good. So I expect a parabola, right? And the parabola also has a minima, right? If I just rotate this tube, let me just show you. Say, just imagine that this straw that I have is basically the cylinder, okay? Here, I have marked that this side maybe is zero and the other side is maybe pi, okay? So one side I have marked, this is maybe pi and the other side of it maybe zero. Okay, this was my velocity versus velocity and theta. This is the cylinder that we are talking about. Now, if this folds and becomes like a parabola, then I have something like this. Okay, so if you can see it here or if you can visualize it, just imagine that I have a tube like this and I have folded it like that because now it is V square. Then it satisfied the basic condition that from below it is protected. Okay, so here the energy would be -1.
-1.
Below which the energy cannot go. Okay, so for small energies, what will happen? So for small energies, I have only this, just let me draw this on my copy, you will be getting it better, I guess. So let us draw this tube. Interestingly, it is named U-tube, right? Because it looks like U. So this is the U-tube space where one side you are plotting energy, other side you are plotting theta. Just think you have bent it into a U-shape, okay? And the below here, I have E is equal to -1, okay? Now for small energies, I have somewhere here. I am somewhere here, okay? The energy is fixed somewhere here. Okay, that means just around the surface of the U-tube, around the surface of the U-tube, you can have these rotations and these rotations are nothing but these graphs. Okay, around the surface, just imagine that around the surface of the U-tube you are rotating like this. You have the structure like U, and you have in the bottom you are rotating like this. Okay, so that means your energy value is zero, is minus one, means you are sitting at the bottom. If your energy is little bit more, then you are just grazing the surface like this, and your velocity gives rise to these small circles like this. Okay, as the energy grows, your welding also grows, your rotational amplitude also grows. So you can rotate like this, or you can rotate like that. Okay, then you reach this point where the U is actually bending. This is your saddle. At the saddle point, you have just reached a limit beyond which you cannot cover the entire thing like this. You can either move inside this like that, or inside this like this. Okay, that means your energy as if remains same, the energy value remains same, but your way, your direction of rotation gets changed. That simply means that if you have a pendulum like this and you are applying enough energy so that it reaches on the top and welds like this, then it can go like this way, clockwise direction, or if you have kicked it harder in this direction, then it could go in the anti-clockwise direction as well. So in terms of the straw, if I show you that, let us consider that zero is at one side and pi is on the other side, and now I fold it. If I fold it, then you will see that the zero and the which way you will fold, that depends on that. So either the pi will be inside, sitting inside for the both tubes, right? So if this side was zero and this side was pi, for this one, this side will be zero and this side will be pi. Do you agree with me? Right? If you fold it, just imagine that you had a simple long tube and you folded it. Now, after folding, if I fold it this way, then pi would be inside for both of them. So if your direction of rotation is from zero to pi, or your rotation is from pi to zero, that is clockwise or anti-clockwise, you will have your paths pointed out in terms of these lines. Okay, I can understand that this might be a little bit critical, but try to just get it in a more concrete kind of a way. Just draw your U-tubes beautifully and try to see that how you can draw different trajectories. These are different trajectories that can form inside the phase space in terms of the U-tube. So the bottom layer, the very bottom of the dynamics would be here, where E is equal to one. Small oscillations would be like this, and then rotating from the other side, it will come back like this. Okay, big oscillations starting from here goes like this, comes back like that. Okay, big oscillations, then you reach the saddle. Once you reach the saddle, you can either go clockwise or anti-clockwise. So if I started with my long tube where zero was on this side and pi was on this side, and now I have folded it, then this side is pi now and this side is zero now, right? So if you are rotating in a clockwise direction in this side, if you are rotating from zero to pi, then this is the direction that you have, okay? Pi to zero, if you're going from pi to zero, then this is the direction that you have. And the same direction looks the other way in this side, because your pi and zero have swapped their position. So a same directional line like this will be the opposite directional mode. So if this is anti-clockwise, then this is clockwise. Okay, so one side means clockwise whirling over the top. This is counterclockwise over the top. Okay, here you have the limit E is equal to one. That is your saddle. This is your limit E is equal to one, the saddle. this is your bottom line, E is equal to minus 1. That is your bottom line, max minimum value of the energy. Okay. And any energy higher than E is equal to 1, that is this entire region, are basically the rotations, not oscillations. These are rotations. These are your oscillations. Okay. So if you are confused,
at no point of time you are not leaving the surface, right?
No, I'm not leaving the surface. I'm on the surface only.
Okay.
I'm on the surface only because that actually signifies that my energy is fixed, right? My energy is fixed. That is why I have to be at a certain value of energy and I have to remain on the surface. At no point of time I'm leaving the surface. Okay. And the shape of the surface actually tells me the shape of these trajectories, these phase space lines. Okay. If small oscillations, then I will have almost circular things. If for big oscillations, I will have like a spread out elliptical kind of thing. And then I will have welding over the top. Okay. So I can understand that this might take some time for you to absorb the entire story in terms of the energy. But this is a very important point where you start mapping these things in terms of energy, because it becomes really beneficial sometimes to understand systems which are not solvable directly, but you can add some little terms to these equations and solve them, just like damping. So I asked you to think about damping, right? In damping, you had this, you already told me that you will have spirals, and that was very true. So can you think that what will happen if I have a damped oscillator here? If I have a damped oscillator, then just remember that that is not a conservative system, right? That there the energy is going down and down. So if I have a damped oscillator and I start from here, I make it vigorously rotating around the entire thing. I start somewhere here, but the energy is continuously degrading. Then what kind of a graph, what kind of lines do you expect here?
Spiral, but falling downwards.
Very good, very good. So let me start from here. If I start from here, I will have lines like this, right? Because it is falling, its energy is, this is my energy axis, remember? So the energy is continuously decreasing. It will go like this, and then it will come, it will again go like that, right? And it will come and it will settle down at the bottom. Do you agree that something like that will happen?
Yes, ma'am.
So it will go on the surface of the YouTube and come and down, settle down at the origin, because it will lose all its energy at some point or other, right? So this is how the diagram will look like for a system where you have energy, losing energy. So try to figure out the same energy expression that we have wrote down, like that was half theta dot square plus, minus cos theta for our oscillator. Just add a term, damping term, right? So add a damping term in the equation of motion, which will be proportional to theta dot, proportional to the velocity. That is how damping works, right? You know that. So put a term like that in your equation and try to see that it is not a conservative system, and try to draw this monotonically decreasing trajectories in your energy versus theta space. Okay, so this is it. I will stop here for today. And basically we are wrapping up all our discussions on phase space, fixed points, two variable, multivariate systems here. There are some problems that I wish to discuss, but maybe I will not have enough time, and we are dealing with this for long. So maybe I will leave that for assignments and all, so that you can get a flavor of it. For example, these double well potentials. So suppose I have a potential energy where, instead of a simple harmonic oscillator where you have just one valley, you have two valleys, okay, separated by a hill. What kind of a diagram like this you expect from there? So you can see that if I have two valleys, then you will have small, you can have small oscillations in both of them, both of the valleys independently. And you can have big oscillations. If the energy is really large, then you can have big oscillations like this, right? So what will be the shape of the phase space? How can you draw those trajectories? What will be the shape of the YouTube graph there? So these questions can arise with some more critical and more nonlinear systems, where you have behaviors like bistability. These are called bistable systems, by the way, where you have two valleys separated by a hill. So we are almost done with our discussion on phase space and multivariate system. The thing that is still left off is the question of sustained oscillations, which I mentioned once or twice, that in all these oscillations that we have seen, pendulum we have analyzed so well, and if you add the sine theta term, there is not much in other oscillatory behaviors. This is it. If you understand this, you understand all the oscillators of this world. But these are not sustained oscillations. In this particular, from the perspective of natural sustained oscillation, what I mean is that even if you have a constant energy system, just imagine, though we don't have any such system in our world, just imagine that I have a completely conservative system, energy is completely conserved, and an oscillator is oscillating like this. A simple pendulum is oscillating like this. But perturbations are always there. Noise is always there. So suppose I have a certain pendulum and it is oscillating at a particular amplitude A. Okay? And then a certain small noise comes into the picture and A becomes B. A becomes B, where B is a little bit larger amplitude. If that energy once goes inside the system, even in a conservative system, there is no way to get that energy out. So if the amplitude changes from A to B, it will remain at B, right? If it is a center that is giving rise to this oscillation, that is bound to happen, because this is how centers are designed. If you change the trajectory a little bit, if you add a little bit of energy, you get a bigger trajectory and you settle down there. But there are several oscillations in this world which are conserved, like a fixed point. That means like the heartbeat, as I mentioned, like my heartbeat is constant. Even if I get a little bit of palpitation and my heartbeat goes up, it does not stay there, right? It again comes back and settles down at a certain value. How do this happen? Cell division cycle. You have all learned about that in school, right? That is kind of a consistent circle. Small perturbations cannot disturb that kind of a oscillation. Okay, so the question that we want to address in our next class, I will just graze upon the subject because limit cycles are a huge discussion. They can contribute in a huge discussion on their own, but I will just graze upon the subject of limit cycles, that how I can get oscillations where I will have these beautiful properties that I have a circular path in my phase space, okay, and all the trajectories from everywhere come and settle down on that particular path. It remains there. It goes on forever, oscillating on this path. Even if you start from inside, it comes and settles down on that particular path. And it remains there. It goes on oscillating there. Small perturbations will not destroy it. It will come back and settle down with the same amplitude, with the same period, it will settle down there. Our world is full of such oscillators, so it will be not fair if we don't discuss limit cycles even a little bit. So I will discuss limit cycles a little bit in the next week, and I will also discuss a little bit about fractals, because those are also interesting, and chaos a little bit. So maybe 2-3 more classes and then we will conclude for this semester. Okay, so today I am ending up our discussions with all these rigorous mathematics and rigorous differential equations, multivariate systems, phase space, and just limit cycles, and small discussion on fractals, and we will conclude. Okay, so let us stop here for today. Any questions, any doubts, you can ask. Okay, so if you don't have any questions, let us stop here for today. And we will meet on the Thursday's class next week with our discussion on limit cycles.